Meep.
Ari Aster is one of the most celebrated directors of the last decade. He's only made two feature films, both of which are disturbing and divisive, and yet he has managed to achieve not only box office success, but he has caught the attention of prolific filmmakers such as Martin Scorsese and won the hearts of film school dropouts everywhere, like me. Ari Aster is part of a modern horror renaissance, a movement which I deeply respect. I own both of his films on 4K Blu-ray, I have posters of them above my bed, I make blood sacrifices to A24 every night. So just know that going in when I say that I am officially frustrated with Ari Aster as a filmmaker. You know that feeling you get when you watch a really bad movie that could have been really good and you so desperately want to fix it so you can just watch a good movie instead of dog shit? That's the exact feeling I get every time I watch an Ari Aster film, except instead of watching a good movie trapped inside of a bad movie, I'm watching a masterpiece trapped inside of a great movie. I'm going to be spoiling the entirety of both Hereditary and Midsommar, so if you haven't seen them, despite everything that I'm going to say here, I still highly recommend that you watch them. They are important films, both for horror and filmmaking as a medium, and they should be cherished, but now let's talk about why they're f***ing terrible. This movie fucked me up so bad the first time I saw it. I didn't know much about the film other than the fact that it was receiving critical acclaim. Usually when a horror film gets good reviews, it just means, well, it's not a complete piece of shit. Before Robert Eggers and Jordan Peele entered the picture, you were really taking a gamble on seeing a horror film because you were either about to watch a decent movie or a movie that was so bad you were gonna want to gouge your eyes out. Even some of the more acclaimed horror films of this decade feel so forgettable, but I will never forget my experience watching Hereditary. This film is brooding and horrific. A little girl gets brutally decapitated, and then you just watch her family tear themselves apart for 2 hours. The film forces you to dwell in its themes of inherited grief, trauma, and mental illness. It is thought-provoking, it is uncomfortable. The performances are excellent, especially from Toni Collette. The soundtrack is absolutely gorgeous. Ari Aster executes every scene with the technical precision of a master craftsman. The film just continues ramping up with intensity as you feel the impending dread of a sinister conclusion. And then it turns out it was just payment the entire time. Oh. That's f***ing boring. Hereditary's strength as a horror film stems from the fact that a lot of what happens just feels very tangible. The characters and the situations they're forced into are portrayed with such emotional honesty that you cannot help but get enveloped in them. Charlie is clearly not a normal kid. She's got weird tics, she's got a nut allergy, she clearly does not fit in with her family or at school, and then she gets her fucking head knocked off. And then you got Naked Brothers Band over here, a normal teenager who is infantilized by his sister's death. And then of course there is the mother, played excellently by Toni Collette, who is suffering with so much grief and trauma right from the start of the film, and then you have to watch her daughter die in the most horrific way possible and just see how that completely destroys her as a human being, and that is easily the most unsettling thing in the film. But then Satan, it completely undermines all of that. When asked about the ending of Hereditary in an interview with Slate.com, Ari Aster said, "The movie is trying to have it both ways. Then in the end, there are some clear-cut answers that will either disappoint or satisfy the audience. I think there will be a lot of people who will likely be disappointed by that ending because it's maybe not ambiguous enough. It's too clear cut. I know a lot of people who hate the ending of Rosemary's Baby and wish that it was left ambiguous, but I can't imagine Rosemary's Baby without that ending." I agree. I can't imagine Rosemary's Baby without that ending either. It is amazing and deeply impactful, but the reason that ending is not satisfying or cathartic in Hereditary is because I've already seen that ending before. In Rosemary's Baby. The rest of the film is extremely daring in its themes and execution, but by the end you realize you just got tricked into watching the art house version of a Paranormal Activity movie. It's not even that the occult aspects are handled poorly, in fact they're very well set up, and putting the pieces of the ritual together through the context of the film is fun, but it ultimately cuts the legs out from under the film.
The story is, I believe, I've forgotten some of it, I'm sorry, but what I didn't forget was the family, the three of them. Yeah. And that's what's important in terms of this filmmaker.
Yeah.
And these actors, they're astounding. The actual supernatural plot to it, I remember, of course, and I remember the ending very well. But what I really think is powerful in the film is really the family dynamic.
Yeah. It feels like Ari Aster wanted to make a moving, terrifying film about heavy themes, but then it scared him so much he decided, fuck it. Don't be scared, it was just Satan the whole time, like we were watching Scooby-Doo or the Hash-Slinging Slasher, and not one of the most disturbing and depressing films in years. Funny enough, I feel like this film and Super 8 have the same fundamental flaw. Dark films about a family dealing with loss and grief that just magically become completely different, much less interesting films in the third act. I adore Hereditary to death, and I still say it is easily among some of the best horror films ever made, but my god, this film just gets more and more disappointing every time I watch it, but not nearly as disappointing as Midsommar. I also vividly remember my theater experience watching Midsommar only 1 year after Hereditary's wide release, and we were already getting more Ari Aster. I'm gonna fuck up this man's name so many times. Only 1 year after Hereditary's wide release, and we were already getting more Ari Aster, and I was so excited. After the horrific shit that I saw in Hereditary, I thought I was ready for anything. But then the film just immediately hits you with easily one of the most gut-wrenching things I have ever seen in a film of any kind. And that's when my expectations just went completely out the window. As the film continues, a relationship on the rocks is tested as Danny, our main character, is forced to confront the grief of her family's horrific death when she is brought to a Swedish cult's Midsommar festival, complete with banquets, singing, dancing, and people jumping off of cliffs and having their skulls crushed in with mallets. Like Hereditary, rituals and grief both play a big role in the film, but the difference being that the emotional core of this film focuses almost solely on the toxic relationship between Danny and Christian. Also like Hereditary, it features an outstanding lead performance, this time from Florence Pugh. This film has beautiful and haunting imagery that will burn itself into your retinas. I don't even know how much of this movie I'm allowed to show. I'm pretty sure this video is going to get age restricted. On a technical level, this film is an absolute masterclass. The cinematography and editing are both executed brilliantly, and once again, Ari Aster shows his cinematic prowess. This dude is seriously so talented. This is his second feature film, and it looks this incredible. That is nothing short of miraculous. So it's a damn shame that he wrote the most one-dimensional and unlikable characters ever. Every single character in this film is flat. We've got sympathetic protagonist, asshole, asshole, college thesis, and secret asshole. I know this sounds like a gross oversimplification of these characters, but I swear to you, it is not. The characters in Hereditary all felt very grounded and depthful, except for the dad. He's just kind of there. But you got to see their lives and emotions from multiple angles, learning about their traumatic pasts. So when you saw them fall apart, you could empathize with them so strongly, even when you disagreed with their actions. Your emotional investment in the characters is what makes that film so tragic and heartbreaking to watch, even during all the satanic panic bullshit. In Midsommar, all of the character depth that would make the film worth emotionally investing in is completely stripped away. Everybody is just one singular thing. Now, in some cases, I don't mind that, like with Eyebrows Dude from Where the Millers. That dude's character is just a complete dickhead with no regard for Northern European culture or empathy for other human beings, and that is completely fine. But when both of the characters in the relationship, which makes up the entirety of the film's emotional core, are both equally one-dimensional, then you have a serious problem. It's gonna sound like I'm nitpicking here, but Danny and Christian's relationship is literally the entire emotional crux of the film. Ari Aster himself has confirmed this.
I wrote this while I was going through a pretty bad breakup after a long-term relationship, and I wanted to make a film that, you know, that felt as big as a breakup feels. You know, like from a distance, if it's happening to someone you know or somebody else, it's like this silly thing and they're gonna get over it and, like, you know, just pick yourself up by the bootstraps. But when you're in it, it can feel cataclysmic. And so I wanted to make a breakup movie that felt as consequential as a breakup feels.
Let's just compare Hereditary and Midsommar again here for just a minute. In Hereditary, the pieces of the ritual were already in place from the beginning of the film. Payman was going to rise again no matter what anyone did to try and stop it. This was always destined to happen. But the film toys with you and makes you feel like maybe there's a chance that our characters just might break free from this, and then the film very abruptly hits you with the reality of their situation again and again. It is devastating. It's tragic. Because by the point in the film where shit really hits the fan and there's no turning back, you are emotionally invested in these characters and you want nothing more than for their suffering to end. Midsommar's ending is similarly spelled out from the beginning. From the very first minute of the film, you know that Danny and Christian's relationship isn't going to work out. It's clear that Christian wants out and that Danny knows this, but is afraid to lose him. No matter how much they tried, their relationship was not built to last. The difference being that in Midsommar, you are not toyed with at all or made to think that anything besides Danny and Christian breaking up could ever possibly happen. From the beginning of the film to 2.5 to 3 hours later, you know their relationship will crumble, so you just have to sit there and wait through a really elongated Wicker Man homage to get there. We're not ramping up with emotional intensity on our way to the inevitable conclusion. We're just flatlining it the whole way there. Christian is the most selfish piece of shit. He does not care at all about Danny. He's wanted out of the relationship for a long time, and he's just too spineless to say it. He's an awful anthropology student, a terrible friend, and an even worse boyfriend. He's not even hot. He looks like off-brand Chris Pratt. This dude was in Transformers 4. He sucks ass. Watching the film, myself and many others probably asked many times, why in the hell would anyone be in a relationship with this dude? And that is a problem. In order for the ending of the film to have any weight at all, we have to buy their relationship. And I personally did not buy it for a minute. I can only speak from my own experiences, but I was once in a relationship that looked and sounded extremely similar to Danny and Christian's in this film. It was horrible. It was emotionally devastating. It took me years to feel comfortable opening myself up again after that. And I appreciate so deeply that a horror film is attempting to bring the emotional experience of that kind of turmoil, that breakup, to the screen. But I found it really hard to invest in it at all because their relationship has no nuance. I know that in the real world, there are horrible, toxic relationships where all of the blame for everything terrible lies solely on one partner. That absolutely does happen, but that does not make for a very compelling narrative. I feel like it's pretty much screenwriting 101, that complexity makes for more interesting characters. You may not agree with the choices that those characters make, but you at least understand why they choose them. Human beings are complex as hell, and while no person's complexities could ever justify them abusing another person in any way, shape, or form, they're still there. Again, I can only speak from my own experience, but the complexity of the horrible relationship I was in, those fleeting, wonderful moments that I shared with that person, even in the worst of times, are what I used to justify keeping them in my life, even despite constant emotionally manipulative behavior. But Christian in Midsommar doesn't have any complexity. He is just a gaslighting piece of shit. I'm sure in the years before the film takes place, Danny and Christian shared a lot of wonderful moments that both of them cherish. You get the feeling that there's something in Christian that Danny sees, something that's fading over the course of the movie, but I never got a single glimpse as to what she sees in him. So my emotional experience just went straight out the window. Especially during the ending sequence, which comes across like it's supposed to be somewhat tragic. Danny gets to choose whether she wants to kill some dude she doesn't know at all, or kill the dude she's been in a relationship with for years. They present this like it's a hard choice for her, while I just sit there and go, just kill this douchebag already. And what makes this so frustrating is that apparently this is a completely intentional decision on Ari Aster's part.
In this film, it seems like the heart is really with Danny.
Yeah. Well, with Hereditary, I was kind of spread all over. In this film, I really put a lot of myself into Danny. But I've been in Christian's position. I wanted Christian to be at least relatable. But we are so aligned with Danny that there's almost no hope of, like, really siding with the guy. It's all kind of designed to, like, really make you want that ending.
So you're telling me that you want me to see everything from Danny's emotional lens, but you're also telling me that scenes in the film are specifically designed to make me want Christian to get burnt alive in a bear suit. Have you ever heard of the phrase, you can't have your cake and eat it too? For most of the film, it seems like Danny doesn't want things to end between her and Christian. She's kind of grasping at it as hard as she can because she feels like she needs it. So if she is my emotional guide through the story, I should also not want this relationship to end, at least not at first. But the film is giving me no clear reason to feel that way because in almost every single frame of the film, I'm seeing Christian consistently be a piece of shit. If your goal was to display the gargantuan, absolutely cataclysmic feeling that going through a breakup like this will give you, then wouldn't you want to present the relationship in a way that allows for that kind of emotional response? Because to me, this just feels way too straightforward, way too simple. There's only one single fleeting moment through the entire film where I understood this relationship, and that was the moment where Danny wants to wait to take mushrooms, and Christian actually defends her choice and stands with her in solidarity until she caves into peer pressure from his friends. And that's just one moment in a 2.5 to 3 hour movie, depending on which version you watch. Was this one moment supposed to be enough to make me care? You never even once get to see him do something sweet for her, even on a superficial level, like a scene where he gets Danny a small cake for her birthday and they hug and everything seems happy for just one little blissful moment. Instead, he forgets her birthday entirely until his secret asshole friend reminds him and he haphazardly tries to correct his mistake, and Danny sees right through his bullshit because he's an asshole. And never was I frustrated with the design of this relationship more than when I watched the director's cut. I thought I was finally going to see the moment I was waiting for in the director's cut, because it includes a nighttime scene that was left out of the theatrical version where Danny and Christian get into a bit of an argument. I really thought we were finally going to get a single moment of emotional honesty between the two of them. And we sort of get that, but we also get,
you're just a self-denying altruist and I'm a paranoid d-.
I was being kind.
Okay. Fine, I'm the asshole.
Nobody's the asshole.
I clearly am.
Yes, that is literally your entire character dynamic. You are an asshole. Danny is an altruist. I feel like an asshole saying that about Danny, but it is true. I know how many people hold her character dearly and how sympathetic people are to her, and I feel the same way. She goes through one of the most horrifying things that's ever happened to anyone ever, and now she's stuck in another country with the dude from Transformers 4. How can you not sympathize with her? But there's a difference between sympathy and empathy. Sympathy meaning you acknowledge someone's emotions without being able to fully understand them, and empathy meaning that you understand someone's pain to the point where you're able to feel it yourself. Which is actually, ironically, a big theme of Midsommar, but the problem is it's really hard to empathize with a person you never really get to know. All I know about Danny is that she has been through more suffering than any human being should ever have to go through, and that she's struggling to deal with that pain. She's an extremely empathetic person to the point where she will place other people's emotions before her own. She apologizes to Christian for him forgetting her birthday. She also takes the same medicine for panic attacks that I used to, so yeah, she's relatable, but not particularly depthful. I'm sorry, but nobody is this perfect. I mean, okay, listen, I know she's not perfect. She has a very deep-seated emotional trauma that is difficult to deal with. We only get to see how hard it is for her to deal with the things that she's gone through. We never get to see how those feelings she's dealing with drive a wedge in her relationship. There's never a moment like the one in Hereditary where Toni Collette cuts herself off from her husband and is very short with him, or where she screams at her son and blames all of her suffering on him. Instead, it just feels like Danny is the idealized version of a grieving person who never does anything selfish or hurtful without justification. And clearly that's an intentional decision, and again, I'm not saying that by the end I feel nothing for her, but I can clearly imagine how much more I would feel if this relationship was portrayed with any amount of depth. I'm fine with an ending that tells us to break off toxic relationships. In fact, I advocate for it. That is a wonderful ending to this story. Danny and Christian's performances, dialogue, and interactions all feel incredibly genuine, but the characters themselves feel so plastic and lifeless, devoid of any depth that would make the film 10 times as horrific and emotionally impactful, for me at least. We should have spent more time with them and gotten a better, more well-rounded look at their relationship. And I know, it just sounds like I'm saying, just make Christian the nice guy and Danny a complete bitch, but that's really not it at all. What I'm saying is make me believe that these people once shared something special. Give me moments where it feels like there's a connection between them that they're both afraid to admit is dying. Play with my emotions a little bit. Make me feel like maybe there is a chance, no matter how small, that things could work out between them. Make me believe that they care, and most importantly, make me care. Instead, I got a movie where the most engaging part of the film was underwritten and overshadowed by a movie that has already been made. Somewhere inside of both of these movies, or in some sort of combination of the two, there is an absolute masterpiece, and that's the film that I want to see. Despite how it may have sounded, I love Midsommar and Hereditary to death, and I will recommend them until the end of time, and I heavily respect Ari Aster as a filmmaker. I am overwhelmingly excited for his 4-hour horror comedy starring Joaquin Phoenix. I'm hoping this will be his magnum opus, but for now, I just wanted to bear some of my grievances with his current filmography. As always, though, this is a conversation. Leave me a comment below just telling me how wrong I am. I would love to talk about these films. So yeah, that ran over. Thanks so much for watching. Meeptop out.